Hi, welcome to Numerix Video Blog. I'm your host, Jim Jockel. Joining me today, Satyam Kincharler, Chief Strategy Officer here at Numerix, and Steve Davis, Chief Architect of Vector Risk. Gentlemen, welcome.
Thanks, Jim.
So I want to talk about FRTB, and really kind of a lot has been said. You know, we're at a pivotal time frame right now as a lot of the banks and institutions are looking at potential assessments and potential impact of the implementation around FRTB. So Sadia, let today's discussion, we're going to talk about what are some of the greatest challenges that banks are facing today, specifically around FRTB?
Well, the greatest challenges, I would say, are clearly the capital that FRTB imposes. Under the standardized methodology, you have maybe up to 140% more capital. Under IMA, up to 40 or 60% more. So that's the single biggest challenge. And what it does to business models, what it does to desks, and clearly there are technology challenges and data challenges and all of the challenges behind that. But at a business level, the biggest challenge is capital and how to optimize capital. I think that's the question.
So you mentioned technology. So Steve, let me turn to you. I mean, obviously, we're talking massive amounts of data, massive amounts of inputs. What are some of the challenges that you're seeing as a chief architect in terms of dealing with this?
So when banks look at their current risk system, they don't even match up to the P&L as it stands. So even if they could do the full internal model calculation, they would still fail the tests, the P&L tests that are coming. And this has been the big problem for them. They don't have a sort of a straightforward way forward to get FRTB working. They can look at the risk solution and say, well, even if we replace it, we still don't, our current one doesn't match up to P&L. How do we know our new one will? So what the banks have been looking at doing is that they're looking at the problem from the other end and saying, how do we simplify our P&L so that when we do finally get around to having a risk solution, it lines up. So unfortunately, given the dearth of systems out in the marketplace for them to work out precisely how close they will be, the new risk systems aren't available yet for FRTB, they have started by trying to rationalize the front office instead of dealing directly with the problem, which is really to improve the P&L process and start improving the risk process.
At what point does a bank need to make the decision that there is a need for an entirely new risk system?
I think banks really do know that that's the situation. And a lot of the talk early on in the process has been from Tier 1 banks, and they have the resources to build their own risk system, and they also have the resources. They recognize the same thing, that their P&L process is too complex, their risk system will never match up, they've got multiple end of days, they've got so many reasons why they need to also re-engineer the P&L process. And so that's the thing that chatted with Tier 1 banks, but unfortunately in re-engineering the P&L process, they sort of talk about reducing the number of front office systems. It becomes a very big, complete system overhaul for the front office. The primary point that Satyam raised earlier, that the desk structures are going to optimize capital, are sort of lost in the mix because they're so concerned with getting the process of system realignment going before they actually have the answers on where they need to, that maybe they shouldn't be touching their front office systems. What they really should be doing is focusing on a calculation that gives them to see where the alignment's out and start focusing particularly on their P&L process. Because if they can get the P&L process cleaned up, they don't need to replace the front office systems. They might need to step back a little bit and move the P&L process more into the middle office, which is kind of a different approach to what a lot of the banks have been thinking. They've been thinking about moving their risk process into the front office. Front office systems are large, they take a long time to install, they're not really proven good implementation sites for risk processes where you need independent oversight, you need to be able to rerun things, you need to be able to go back and see what the situation was yesterday, the day before. These are all problems that have been solved over the years on the risk side. And suddenly banks are thinking we're going to throw all that away and we're going to move into the front office and suddenly build it all up again just because we want to have common models, just because we want to pass the P&L test. So I see that probably the big banks, the Tier 1 banks have got the resources to attempt that, but smaller banks really, if they just focus on the P&L process that they have, which is probably a lot simpler, sure, it might not match up with their current risk process because who's invested enough in the risk process, but that problem can be attacked directly. And I think if there's a system out there that can give you the impact for capital the Satyam raise and also start giving you some comfort around aligning with your P&L, then that should be a much more direct, direct approach for banks to take.
Satyam, we've seen budget reports on FRTB implementation ranging anywhere from a $5 million implementation to a $150 million overhaul. What are some of the drivers you're seeing in that disparity? Is it, you know, is it the reduction or a complete replacement of a risk infrastructure? You know, what is causing the wideness of that number?
Well, if you just take FRTB one step at a time, you see there are a lot of data requirements, first of all. To bring in all of the data, marshal everything from different parts of the bank, do a lot of data set tests and so on. And then on top of that, a couple of things that really stretch in terms of the analytics are the capabilities. One is the P&L that Steve mentioned that needs to be consistent. So you're really pushing the models to be far more accurate than they were before. The other thing is performance. So we've seen estimates where the number of times these calculations have to be done is a multiple of what we saw under Basel III. So it's a 60x multiple in terms of how many expected shortfall calculations you want to be doing. Now, if you add on top of that all of the what-ifs that people want to perform, all of the drill downs that people want to perform, the performance requirements are really, really huge. So these are just the basics. These are just the bread and butter of FRTB. Now, what's happening, obviously, is you look at all of these requirements that touch every aspect of how a bank manages its risk across the first, second, and third line of defense in terms of risk, and we're really looking at an entire transformation across the bank. So if you start looking at it that way and rationalize systems and so on and so forth, as Steve mentioned, that could be a much, much bigger undertaking, so which is why it could be a smallish undertaking if it's looked at very tactically. But even in that case, we're talking about a very large project, or it could be a complete overhaul, a complete transformation of the bank's investment banking systems.
A couple of years ago, probably about 5 years ago, I remember sitting down having a conversation with a CTO, and I said, you know, where is your cloud strategy? And he said to me, you know, he said, Jim, the probability of us using the cloud for anything other than procurement of pencils will never happen. But yes, we're starting to see more rapid adoption and more acceptance of cloud-based solutions and cloud technologies for distributed compute across the financial service sectors. What's the state of the cloud today?
Okay, the wind has changed. So we're hearing banks where you have to argue against the cloud if you don't want to use it, whereas it used to be the other way around. Risk processes are an obvious case because risk, even FRTB, FRTB in particular, the daily process, it's the end of the line, it's got a very high CPU requirement or, you know, calculation requirement for a short period of time. I mean, then with reruns and stuff that might go on. But you've got the need for a lot of technology. You're sort of an end of the line process, and compared to transactional systems, the risks are less obvious. You know, the data obviously needs to be protected, and you've got people like Microsoft Azure and Amazon with some of the best protections in the world now on the cloud. But even so, even if those protections were breached, the FRTB data is inherently less sensitive than transaction data. So you've got lots of reasons to use something like FRTB as the first serious movement to the cloud. And really, the cost pressures are going to force it to happen because not in the very long run, in pretty much in the short run, with increasing capital, as we've talked about, and the incredible costs of running these systems in-house, and that they're always incredible costs. The hardware becomes redundant. Every upgrade becomes a process with a lot of moving parts, a lot of people involved. The costs just are there all the time, and there's not that much profit in the financial markets. If you've got to meet an ROE hurdle with the new capital requirements, you're going to have to cut costs as well. And how do you cut costs when FRTB is four times more complicated than the previous version? Well, one of the ways is to start moving into the cloud and start to commoditize. I mean, let's face it, FRTB needs to be the same for all banks. So a solution on the cloud that multiple banks use that is actually the same solution starts to make more sense than ever before.
Well, gents, I want to thank you so much for joining us today. And of course, we want to talk about the topics that you want to talk about. So please follow us on LinkedIn or on Twitter at NX Analytics. Thanks so much, guys.